Hey now, this is Jason Acorn with the Boneyard, and you are listening to Jason on the Outdoor Adventures with Jason.
Welcome to Outdoor Adventures with Jason. Each week, I bring the world of hunting, fishing, and conservation to you. From the great hunting and fishing opportunities found in the Americas to the dream safaris located on the dark continent beyond, I'll introduce you to those who are already out in the field living every outdoor enthusiast's dream, as well as outfitters and gear manufacturers that can make those dreams your reality. Kill Instinct's arrows are for the serious hunter, a company that understands the needs of the outdoorsman and provides five different styles of carbon fiber arrows, ranging from hunting to tournament arrows. If you want premium carbon fiber arrows, go to killinstix.com to review their carbon arrows. For listeners of the Outdoor Adventures with Jason show, use promo code OUTDOORS to get 10% off your first order. Kill Instinct's, where the blood trail begins. This episode of Outdoor Adventures with Jason was taped before the National Wild Turkey Federation's conference took place in Nashville in February of 2018. You're going to hear a couple items discussed about that, but again, please head out and check out Jeff's website at tagitworldwide.com, and I hope you enjoy the show. Welcome to this episode of Outdoor Adventures with Jason. Today, I'm really excited. As many of you heard in past episodes, I am gotten bit by the turkey hunting bug. I've never been turkey hunting before, but this next guest is maybe really going to help me fill out that first hard bird. I've got Jeff Budz on. Jeff is the owner of Tagit Worldwide, and Jeff is an immensely accomplished turkey hunter, and I'm going to let him tell you about that. But Jeff, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. How are you today?
Hey, I'm fantastic, and I really appreciate the time because many people just don't understand that once this turkey hunting thing takes a hold of you, you kind of start getting just turkey on the brain. And I want folks to really hear from a master like yourself about what it takes and where it's at with the turkey hunting. And could you give the listeners a little background on you, Tagit Worldwide, and most importantly, talk about the number of turkey slams that you've completed so far?
Hope everybody's sitting down and got some popcorn and a drink because it's going to be a while. No, I'll kid aside. So in college, I got the bug. Buddy took me out on my first hunt and called in two little scrawny jakes in 1989, April 1st. And then I went 2 years without getting a bird, and that was it. I couldn't believe it. And so in 92, I shot. So I didn't get one in 90 and 91. 92, I said, that's it. I'm going to go until I get one. I did. After that, I said, that's it. This is what I'm about, turkeys. And through a long transition and road and such, I started a company, Tagit Worldwide, and I guide turkey hunts. I do a bunch of stuff. But my basic premise was and goal was to be surrounded by turkeys and hunting and to make sure that that was my living and nobody could ever say, don't go hunting. So that's what I do and have done for the last 20 years. Along the way, I've accumulated 97 Grand Slams. I live in Florida, have for the last 13 years, and the Osceola is, the elusive Osceola is the hardest one, and I've got him in my backyard. You know, I guide for Grand Slams. I guide for Osceolas. I guide Ariens and Rios as well on the side. But everything centers around the Osceola. And so we're at the, what is it, February 6th. I was out this morning at 6 o'clock listening for birds and, you know, because our season in the southern zone opens March 3rd. But it's everything about eat, sleep, breathe, turkeys. I mean, my phone rings, of course, because it's a business, but I talk about turkeys every single day of the year. 360 days of the year, I bet you, I talk about to somebody at some point about turkeys, information, public ground. I make a living at booking, but I still, there's all kinds of opportunity. Nowadays, the Grand Slam is sort of passe, and everybody talks about the Super Slam, which getting a turkey out of all 49 states. There's none in Alaska. So guys try and do that and facilitate them getting another two or three states a year. Because again, it's just a long process. It took me, 15 years, 18 years to accomplish that. And now, it's about taking the kids and the other people. And, I just love it. I eat, sleep, and breathe and love it.
What impresses the heck out of me is 97. Did I hear that right? 97 slams?
97 slams. Yes, sir. So you can get, legally in Florida, you can get two spring Osceolas and you can get two fall Osceolas. I was the first one to figure that out. I have 1999. I got my first fall two birds, so I harvested and recorded with the NWTF. Four Grand Slams, and I've recorded four Grand Slams since then, and, you know, had slams before 99. So I'm at 99, and I'll get turn 100 this year in 2018. And then I've been asked, well, then what do you do? And I say, well, then I go for 204 and 208 and 200, I mean, 104, 108, 112, and I just keep, I can't imagine not getting four Grand Slams every year from now until good Lord calls me home.
Now, when you look, and aside from the turkey hunting that you do with Taggett Worldwide, you really offer a number of options for that person, whether they want to do just the Osceola hunt or whether what I think is amazing is a whole single season Grand Slam that they can do with you. Or even trophy alligators, if you're in Okeechobee, darn near in your backyard, probably.
Yeah, yeah. It's funny, you know, I just had a friend in last week, and we're driving down the road, and they, oh my gosh, and I don't even bat an eye, and there's an alligator hit on the side of the road, just like if you're in Kansas, and you look over and see a whitetail, and somebody, what's that? You know, so, but yeah, hogs and alligators and turkeys, Grand Slams. I do a Miriam Rio camp out west, and just whatever to keep me from March 3rd until, oh, I get done. I'm booked until Mother's Day. I promised Mom I'd be home for May 13th on Sunday the 13th. So I start scouting. Well, I was scouting today, and it'll start to get more and more right before the March 3rd. But I'll go 10 weeks of turkey hunting every day with myself, friends, clients, you name it. Filming, scouting, whatever. I'll be in the woods every day for 10 weeks. In and around turkeys. So it just, you know, I eat it up, and I can't wait. And towards the end, when most people would be crushed and collapsed and tired, I just thrive on it because I know this is it for the next until fall picks up and I get to chase them again. So I just love it.
Well, now, so if I understand right, I can come in and maybe I can't do or afford the single season Grand Slam at the moment, but I can start off and do the Osceola with you and then do a Miriam maybe the following year or something like that. You can guide on all those different hunts as a single pack, single hunt.
Yeah. I don't do much with the Easterns. When I book a single season Grand Slam with a client, then I go to Georgia and we hunt there or North Florida because there's Easterns right on the Georgia line, so they come in and they'll shoot one Osceola, one Eastern, go out west and shoot one Miriam and one Rio with me. But yeah, you don't have to get a Grand Slam. You don't have to do it in a day, a week, a month, or even a year. Some guys, it takes 15 years to get all those birds. They usually hunt Easterns because everybody has Easterns in their backyard, or 80% of the turkey hunters, because there's so many states with Easterns. So that's why I don't focus on Easterns. I do South Dakota, Kansas, and Nebraska for Merriams and Rios, and then Florida and Georgia for the Osceola and a couple Easterns. So, yeah, we do it however a guy is going to want to do it. And I can facilitate it, that's what I do.
Oh, fantastic. So the easiest way is really to contact you, and I'll have your website and phone number in the show notes. So anybody that wants to contact you, all they have to do is go into the show notes here, click on the link to Taggett Worldwide, and you'll be right in Jeff's neighborhood to be able to contact him.
Exactly.
So talk a little bit because everybody talks about, to get the slam, you got to have the Osceola. The Osceola is obviously probably the most limited of the birds to hunt just because of location. And are they any more difficult to hunt, say, than a Eastern or a Rio?
No, you know, you nailed it, Jason, from supply and demand standpoint. You know, there's Easterns in 20 some states, there's Rios in 10 or so, and Miriams in 10 or so. Well, you get Osceolas and they're in one half of one state, and that's Florida. So you have to go to Florida, and there's big ranches. There's not little 160s and 80s and 40s where you fight all over the Midwest. So there's not doors to knock on, and that's how I've figured out how to make a living at it and come in and then befriend all these big ranches, and I've got thousands of acres and birds. So I go and get the Osceola, get them lined up. But in the woods, everybody, for a Grand Slam, bar none, the Osceola is the hardest. But in the woods, once you're in the woods, the Eastern is a much harder bird to hunt, much more wary, smarter, more cunning. Everything is slice and dice, bird for bird, on a scale from 1 to 10. An Eastern is a 10. An Osceola is probably a 5 or 6. Miriam and a Rio are real close. They're probably 2 and 3. There's that much difference between the four birds. And, you know, I think the Miriam's probably, we'd call it a 2, a Rio's a 3, an Osceola's a 5, and an Eastern's a 10.
Really?
Mono a mono once you're in the woods. Yep, yep. So an Osceola, once you get down here, you know, you're going to get your bird. I mean, that's what I do.
So as long as you can hit it, you're going to get it.
Yep. I had two guys that didn't get a bird last year of all my birds, and they had 5 shots between the two of them at birds at toms less than 30 yards. And I can't do any better than that. I mean, I tried, the only way I guarantee it is if I get a carrier gun, and neither you nor I want to do that.
You might as well give them a slingshot next time.
Yeah.
They might have better luck. So talk a little, do you do anything with the New Mexico, Arizona, the small pocket of Goulds?
No. There's such a small pocket and hard to get those. I do Goulds down in Mexico.
Okay.
I've got an outfitter I work with, and just do a group or two. It's a real reasonable deal, and so that works out. And, you know, oscillated, I'd love to nail something down, but, you know, it's tough dealing. People don't realize how tough it is dealing with different countries and rules and regs and languages, and how, you know, if you haven't traveled, people just don't realize how incredible we have it in this country.
So what is it like when you get down to Mexico for the Goulds turkey compared to, say, the Osceola or even the Eastern?
Well, it's once you're in the woods and you get through the worrying about the cartel or whoever you worry about as you being a normal person and thinking about traveling. But once in the woods, it's like hunting the out west and arid and mountains, and the Goulds are so much like a Miriam. Really high-pitched gobble. You're dealing with ravines and such, and so it's just like hunting a Miriam once you get down there. So
not a super difficult hunt.
No. And you know, again, hopefully people do their homework and they ask for references and they Google a person's name, and nowadays with your smartphone, in minutes, you can find out anything and everything you ever wanted to know about somebody, good or bad, and the bad's going to go screaming at you.
Sure.
So, you know, if there's not any huge bad red flags, then, you know, go for it. So that's easy enough nowadays.
So somebody comes in and they start to plan that first turkey hunt with you. Because of supply and demand and the increased demand on the Osceolas, is that what you usually recommend they start with as they head to Florida and knock that one out as the prices keep increasing?
You know, honestly, of everybody that's hunted with me, 90-80% of the people finish with their Grand Slam with the Osceola. The others, it's always the Miriam. And those two birds, because everybody has Easterns in their backyard, for some reason or another, they go and they hunt a Rio. But of 99% of the people I've ever been with to finish their Grand Slam, which I should have kept track, but it's hundreds. And, you know, it's incredible to me, even to this day, for somebody to get their first bird or finish their Grand Slam or whatever they've accomplished. I just feed off of it. And it's not like my first bird, but as a guy, you know, what came first, the chicken or the egg? But I get so much out of it and appreciate it so much. But it's incredible. I had a little old guy, he was 78, and he went for me with his Miriam. And he'd been twice before, not got a Miriam. And I said, okay, and he couldn't walk much. And we came around the corner. I said, well, you better be ready. We came around the corner, and there was a tom. And he got out and jacked a shell in and had to lean around, and he shot, and he missed. And how the bird just stayed there. He's a retired pasture, and it was just incredible. And he misses. And he, oh no, I've missed my opportunity. I messed up. And he was beating himself up. more than I ever could. And I was just heartbroken. And although I knew, because where I go is so incredible, I knew, I said, come on, Mr. Allen, don't beat yourself up so much. Trust me. It's no, that was it. That was my, well, later that afternoon, there is Miriam. And this is he said, Jeff, I won't admit this to everybody else. I've been married for, I think he said, like 54 years. I've been a pastor my whole life and love God, love Jesus, have four beautiful kids. But I'm telling you what, right now, this moment is, I won't say what's first, but this is the second best thing that's ever happened to me in my life. And for a guy to say that, which is some pretty monumental stuff that's happened to him, and that's everybody can have a successful marriage. Everybody can have a great relationship with God. Everybody can have some beautiful kids. And everybody can chase a grand slam if they want, because I'm all about public ground and working man's grand slam. And it was just incredible the way he said it. It just hit home. And it was like, it was a moment that I'll never forget. Me at the time, you know, 90 some grand slams and shoot 20 plus birds a year, and I've killed 450 whatever birds total. And he's killed a handful and got his first grand slam. And it was just like, it was a tearjerker. It was incredible. So all those great stories is why good guides, people that it's not just about money, but they thrive on those moments, and that's what it's about. And it just keeps me waking up early and going late and keeping after them, you know?
Sure. We all know the old adage of take somebody out, a kid, a vet, you know, anybody that doesn't hunt, and take them out and introduce them to hunting. And it's always exciting. You might have killed 100 turkeys or 100 whitetails, but if you help that person experience their first, that's pretty neat thing to do. That gives you just as good a high as when you get the animal yourself.
Oh, for me, it's I live and thrive and eat, sleep, and breathe it. It's what it's all about. I mean, I somewhere in the 20 birds or so a year for myself personally, and then I guide, oh my gosh, 100, well over 100 birds, and I get to see get thumped every year, and it just, every one of them is just incredible. You know, every one of them means something.
Awesome. Now, there's a picture that flashes on your website that's really cool. It's you standing there with, I think it's a Miriam on a rock with your bow in your hand.
It's either a Goulds from Mexico, because I've two really that stand out, or a Goulds from Mexico if it's a rock. If it's a real rock and you can really tell the detail, or if it's a black stump, then it's my last bird for my Super Slam. That was Arizona.
Got it.
And in May of 2014, or it was a Goulds from Mexico with the bird, beautiful Goulds. So they both look pretty close to similar.
Yeah, it might be the Goulds then, because it's definitely a tan rock. You've got a bow in your hand, so have you taken many of the slams with a bow?
Yeah. So I finished my last bird with that Super Slam. I tried to make it, well, I didn't try and make, I knew I was going to shoot it with a bow anyway, but I messed up on the draw. So the only way to hunt them was over the counter in Arizona was archery. Otherwise you had to draw, which is back in September. So I did my last bird of the 49 states with a bow. So that was pretty cool. But both those birds were great hunts.
Oh, fantastic. Now, so tell a little bit about the equipment that you use when you're bow hunting those.
Well, more times than not, a guy's going to hunt the blind. I started off with Keith and Brooks in 98. They were from Fort Collins, or just south of there.
Uh-huh.
They started double bull blind. So I started out working with those guys. And you know, those are the premier. They've been bought out a few times. Now they're with Primos. But, you know, there's pop-up blinds, so I'll just say pop-up blinds all over. I've got a slew. I just went through them all the other day. I've got 24 blinds because, you know, again, I want to make it comfortable, because to film with a kid, with anybody impaired movement, or with archery equipment, sitting a long time, no vegetation. There's certain scenarios where a pop-up blind is mandatory.
Right.
I set them out for all my guys because I want all my guys to be really comfortable. And again, I'm a facilitator. If a guy wants to run and gun, I say, great, go hunt this property. You know, and you don't have to sit in a blind. Go have fun. You're not going to hunt a big piece of my property on opening day. If you're going to run and gun, that tells me run and scare. So to do justice to everybody and all the birds, I do sort of limit running and gunning. But to go sit and make a blind, I mean, Florida's a great place because there's vegetation year-round, green, thick vegetation. So in a couple seconds, you can cut a couple palmettos and make your own blind. But the pop-up blinds are just phenomenal, you know. So that's a must. And, you know, decoys, when for archery, you want them to come in, you know, hopefully less than 15 yards and put them right up, put the target right in front of you and make it nice, easy chip shot. You know, sitting and waiting for archery is a, you know, all turkey, you know, patience has killed more birds than anything.
Sure.
And for archery, you better be, you know, archery or crossbow, you better be willing to sit and wait a little bit because that's really effective.
Do you prefer that when somebody says, hey, Jeff, I want to use a bow, crossbow, whichever, do you prefer that they come in with a fixed blade broadhead, expandable, or you really don't care?
There are some states, there's some outfitters that dictate, I'm not one of those guys. I want you to feel comfortable, and I'm not going to put any of the blame on me, because if I try and force you to do something, then I'm setting myself up for failure. Myself, I use a 2.5-inch rage, and I just blow them away. And you know, I use a smaller fixed rage for when I shoot big game. But and I've shot a bunch of turkeys with a bunch of different stuff, but that big wide, I love an expandable because I'm not a technical guy, and I know with a field point or a practice blade, I can shoot at the dirt or any target, and I can know right where I'm shooting. I shoot way far out. I love long distances. So when you're shooting fixed blades, they can. If your bow is not tuned, which mine, I'm so hard on all my gear, I don't, and I'm not a technical guy, as I said. So I shoot mechanicals, and if you put it where it's supposed to be, it's gonna do its job. You know, rage through the cage and break the legs and go through the guts, and that's all you need to do.
That bird's not going anywhere.
Well, if they fly, which they do more times than not, they'll fly less than 100 yards, and where they land, they'll be within 5 yards of that spot. If you do your job and you break their legs, they'll get that initial jump, get in the air, but when they land for the first time in their life, they're landing without landing gear, and whatever capacity they had before they landed is completely gone, and they rattle them, finish them, and they're laid, they're there in a daze, and they can't then get back up. So it's incredibly effective. And even if you get one leg, not the best, I mean, it's pretty tough to get both legs, but even if you get one leg, they're still going to crash and tumble, and just that shock is okay. gonna hopefully finish them off, or want to get them to bed down or hunker down, you know?
So you're talking like a side shot where you put the arrow through both of their leg meat?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the hip, you know, and there's all kinds of, there's film, there's carcasses. I have a screenshot of a skeleton, but you want to get that hip socket, because between the two hip sockets is all the guts, and you get one hip, then that means you're going to get guts, and that's all you need. That bird's done.
So you
might have to wait a little bit or look a little bit, but he's done.
So you really try to dissuade somebody with a bow from shooting them like head on?
No, I mean there's. If they're strutting, facing away, you aim right for the butthole. If they're facing you, I aim right below the beard, where the beard goes into the body.
Okay.
I've head, neck shot them. There's all the reasons, rhyme to reasons. My perfect shot is a bird out of strut, so I can see the perfect body. When he's strutting, you got about a third of what that mass is actual meat. And you can mess up and hit nothing but feathers really easy. So I really like a bird out of strut. I love a bird sideways out of strut, so I can see and I can hit that hip bone, where, you know, that's my target. But if he's strutting, I got no problem. Because if he does come in strutting, he's probably going to stay strutting because he didn't try and intimidate. I use the full strut Jake. I only use a Jake decoy because a Tom, and even 2, 3, 4, whatever, he'll see that Jake and want to come fight him. That's what the game plan is.
Oh, okay. What about these guys that come in? For a while, it seemed that it was real big with those guillotine-style blades, those big spinning ones where they'd want to take just the head off.
Uh-huh.
Were those ever really effective, or were they more of a gimmick?
Oh, I've never shot them. I've heard, I've seen some footage. I've never had anybody hunt with one of those, and I'm not... it's just too much because they're completely expanded. They're about a 5-inch head, 5-6 inch total, and there's just too much. When you're shooting, if it hits one little thing, you're done. And right. You have to hit that neck, because if you hit the body, it's not going to do anything. It'll wound the bird, but you're not. I mean, I just don't want to set myself up for failure. And I've had too much success with the others, and I don't need to cut his head off, you know?
Yeah, I always thought that was a kind of an interesting ploy, but I like you said, if you can hit him in the body, you're going to probably kill him.
Yeah, the right spot in the body, yep.
So you like the Rage, and now are you going to be heading up to the National Wild Turkey Convention?
Oh, absolutely. Going home to Mecca. Are you kidding me?
Are you doing any seminars up there or speaking engagements?
You know, this year I'm not. I got pretty busy wrapping up this last year and got so what do you do when you're 50 and you start slowing down? You get married for the first time, and then so that's what I did. So then what do you do? And
congratulations.
What else can we do? So thank you. So now we have we're expecting. We got married on June 10th. My first baby on the way on June 10th of this year of 18. So
oh, congratulations.
I'm pretty excited. And yeah, so it's been a barn burner, and there's so many good people to speak at the NWTF, and I'll probably go sit in on a couple of them, but I sat out this year and letting the other guys get their chance to shine, and just going to go up and meet and greet and just go see what the new products are. And, I mean, it's incredible. They had their biggest year last year, and it's great to see that the industry is still doing well. Everybody talks about hunter numbers going down, birds in the Southeast dwindling, you know, these sort of, you know, the negative of the barometers. I'm an optimistic, positive guy, and it's sure nice to see that many people, families, women. My wife went for the first time, 4 years ago, and she just couldn't believe it. She said, you know, she was excited. She said, you know, she saw all the nice... She said, I was expecting a bunch of rednecks and overalls spitting tobacco. And, you know, it's just so nice. And if you guys haven't ever been, you have to do it and check it off the list, because it's a great organization. They do a whole bunch. You know, there's a lot of good people there that are doing what we all like to do. It's turkey hunt, you know?
Yes, I've become friends with Peter Mueller, who I've interviewed a couple times from the National Wild Turkey Federation. I think it's a great organization, and I've really become a proponent of it. Again, never turkey hunted, but I buy my membership every year, and I'm going to get one of these birds and start that road towards that Grand Slam here. And I look forward to attending the convention next year, because everything I've seen about it looks fantastic.
Yeah, a lot of information there, a lot of product, and you go away with a smile on your face and probably a whole cart full of new stuff, you know?
and a empty checkbook.
Exactly.
So I'm really curious, again, when we talk about that Grand Slam that you do with clients where they can do the single season, how mm-hmm. quickly does that take place from when they start to when they end? What's the period you're talking about of time, and what's the requirements on the hunter? What do they expect from you, and what do you expect from them?
Well, I set it up for a pretty easy deal, because, you know, all of us have to have time and money, and depending on what you have more of, that depends on that. That'll tell you what kind of a hunt, guided, unguided, how fast you can get everything done. So I've been fortunate with my success to line some stuff up and do a single season Grand Slam. This year I charged $9,000, and that gets a guy, what he does, he comes in, he flies into Orlando, gets picked up. We come down, an hour and a half down to camp, and we hunt an Osceola. We jump in the car, and I do two-on-one. So I had two Grand Slam guys in camp at the same time, and they'll both hunt with me. We'll get our Osceola, and then we'll jump in the car and drive six and a half hours up to Augusta, Georgia, and we'll hunt up there for an Eastern. I've got a bunch of really good property up there, and then I'll bring them back to Orlando, and they'll fly out, and that's a four-day hunt. And then that's, the third, fourth week of March, so late March, and then they'll come out the first week of May to Denver. I pick them up in Denver, drive 5 or 6 hours up to northern Nebraska. We hunt Merriam's there. Then we drive down about 5 hours to, and again, it's the same two guys. I have three different, so six guys this year. Two are buddies. The other ones are strangers, but they'll know each other after the hunt because they'll be two trips, 4 days together.
Sure.
And then we drive to Kansas. We hunt the Rio there, and then we drive down back 5 hours to Denver, and I put them on a plane. So 2 4-day trips, 8 days in the with me, and they get there. They get four Toms, Osceola, Eastern, Merriam, and Rio in that order, and they can check it off. I mean, and I've got the guys coming this year. None of them have got a Grand Slam. One has only killed one bird. A couple others have killed several, but mostly Easterns. And they just, they're all pretty affluent kind of guys that have more money than time. Because normally if a guy's going to go book that hunt, for me, just starting out, it's a $2,000 Osceola. Then if you're going to go hunt an Eastern, you're in the $1,500 realm. Rio, $15,000. And Merriam, $1,000, $1,500 as well. So, in four different trips, a guy's going to spend, he's going to spend a bunch in airfares and travel and time, and he's still going to spend $6,000-$7,000.
Right.
So I try and make it better and tame it down as far as the time gone, because for me, or for the guys that I deal with, that's the most important. And honestly, both of those hunts, we could probably get done in 3 days, because, I just save the best of the best. And all that said, all my property is the best. I mean, I don't play around with it. I mean, everybody gets, all they got to do is do their job and let the equipment do its job, and the birds are going to do what they're supposed to do. So they just have to stay out of the bird's way until it's time to pull the trigger and follow through and do what they're supposed to. So
that's pretty simple. Wherever they live, the hunter lives, they're really just talking two plane flights, one to Orlando and one to Denver.
Everywhere, they have nonstop flights to both cities, wherever you are,
And then, you're gonna meet them at both locales. You've got lodging, you've got food set up for them. So really, they just have to be proficient with whatever weapon they're bringing to hunt with.
And a lot of the guys, they shoot my Benellis, and I make it simple because people get freaked out. Oh, what about traveling with weapons? And what about this and that? So I try and make it as simple. I've answered all the questions. I team up with Nomad. They're a great, great proponent of the outdoors. They make a great product. I'm, Federal. I get great ammo. They just came out with their TSS, which is the tungsten. So before, if you wanted to shoot tungsten, you had to make it yourself, and most guys like myself aren't going to be too keen on doing that or proficient. So, right. There's certain things that I've come to love and, not to live without. And I get my guys that are hunting with me and around me, I get them using the same product. So, because I want them to be successful. I'm not setting them up for failure. I'm going to set them up to hit it out of the park. Because if they're successful, then I'm successful.
Right, so that's your name.
I try and surround them with the best. Yeah, exactly.
And then on top of that, you also do, just with the traveling around for the turkeys and all that, on top of that, around your local area, it looks like you could do some alligator hunts.
Yep, we do alligator hunts, hogs with all the TV shows nowadays, everybody. They love hogs and they love alligators. So I'm just a facilitator, and I'm trying to help everybody get what they want. And just like Mama said, the more you help others get what, the faster you help others get what they want, the faster you'll get what you want. So again, I'm just trying to help everybody out because that's what we have: Osceolas, hogs, and alligators around every corner down here.
Well, I'll tell you, I moved here to South Texas about 13 years ago, started hunting hogs, and it's become my favorite animal to hunt. I don't care what anybody says.
Yeah.
You ask me to go hog hunting, I'm gone. I'll do it. Because it's just a blast.
Yeah.
When you do alligator hunts, do you have them come in, shoot a hog to use that as bait to bring in the alligators?
No, we've got 152 miles, big private ranch, 152 miles of canals. And, you know, we figure out what a guy wants because depending on what he wants, the price varies on per foot. And then we go looking and, you know, just like any guide, hopefully you've scouted and you know where different animals are. And you know, there's a lot of alligators. It's really easy. You can hunt them year round, and on private property, you can use whatever your weapons. And it's a, for anybody who's a hunter, you really, it's like, it's going to the grocery store. I mean, you have to do your job, but if the guide's doing his job, whether you're hunting with us or anybody else, you tell him what size alligator you want. And he's going to take you, drive you around, sneak you up. And they're a lot more wary than anybody ever imagined. I mean, I just went on a hunt yesterday looking for a 9 to an 11-foot alligator. And we spooked, probably 6 or 8 before we finally snuck up on. I mean, you got to think of a 10, 11-foot alligator. That's a 50, 60-year-old alligator. It's a dinosaur. And he didn't get that old by being stupid.
Right.
So they catch wind. They catch sight, sound, vibration, they're gone. But, it's again. And then, you know, you just got to put the bullet, you know, show them a chart, put it behind the head and the neck. You want to break their spine and they won't move anywhere. So that's what we try and do. And perfect. It was a one-shot deal. It was great. But again, it's grocery store hunting. It's not true hunting. I mean, it's hunting. Don't make no mistake. But I try and tell everybody the more information that they can imagine, because I want to set everybody up for success. I don't want any misconceptions. I don't want anybody to be disappointed, because if a hunter leaves with or without anything and they're disappointed, it does me or any guide, it does no good. Right. You know?
So do you only allow rifle on the alligator on the private property? You'll let them go with whatever weapon as long as they're proficient.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, if you go and you're trying to shoot a 11-foot alligator and you shoot with a bow, crossbow, pistol, slingshot, whatever, and if you wound that animal and he's 100% wounded and that arrow goes right through the middle of him, you know, there goes a trophy animal, you know. So you want to make sure that you're really proficient and you do what you're supposed to, because, you know, wounding an animal and then there has to come the conversation, oh, now what? Well, you just hit your animal, that animal's going to die, does us absolutely no good. He's going to be floating within a day and rotten, and nobody can do anything with the meat or the hide. So we really push hard on and have everybody shoot, whether it's their weapon or our weapon. Everybody's got to shoot and be proficient. And all of us as hunters, you can be the best on paper in the world, but when you get that crosshair on your target, an animal beating heart, it changes everything. And that's why we all do it. And that's why it's so much fun, you know?
Exactly. So what is the rifle caliber that you guys look at using on a 9 to 11, 11 to 12 foot alligator? What kind of cartridge are you using?
Well, we've got a 25-06 single shot Thompson Center, which is an awesome gun. And I've got a couple myself in there because they're so perfect. That 25-06 with a ballistic tip, I mean, it just wears them out. And, you know, some guys show up with their weapon and they want to shoot their weapon and put a notch on it. And, you know, 25-06, I mean, I shot one myself last year and I used my 6.5 Creedmoor, which is a smaller bullet. It was only 130 grain, but it's smoking out of there. And again, mm-hmm. If you put it in the right spot on the target, you do great. You know, it'll do its job.
Well, yep. We've covered a lot. We've talked about the Osceolas, the single season slam that you do, alligators, hogs. I mean, you're really offering all of it to folks. And the best way to contact you is going to be go out to taggetworldwide.com. And the phone number I see on here is 217-502-1304. And that brings them right into you, where they can talk with you and set up whatever type of hunting adventure around turkeys that you can offer.
That's it.
Man, what an amazing thing. And it just blew my mind. I'm sitting here thinking, I know who I'm doing Osceolas with, and that's you. Because if you can do 97 slams in 20 years or so or less, I don't know why anybody would look anywhere else. So You know, I give you a lot of credit for what you've done, the popular stuff to bring and keep this turkey hunting alive and bring people like myself, because if it wasn't for your Working Man article, that's what really stoked my interest in turkey hunting and got me going. And I appreciate that article. It was really a good read, and I'll have a link to it in the show notes so people can go out and read that. And you do have a few videos out on YouTube, is that correct?
Yeah, sure. I don't pay too much on all the tech stuff, but I think so. Yeah, I've done, during season, I'll get cranked up on that Instagram and Facebook, and there's a new app, Huntwise, and link into that, you know, just to get guys cranked up. And again, because our season starts earlier, the first of anybody's, and so we get in hot and heavy, and I just want to get some information out to folks and keep them excited about it.
Well, fantastic. Well, I can't tell you how much I appreciate your time. This has been so good. And folks, again, contact Jeff. He's the one that's going to put you on the birds. Whether you got more money than time or you got a lot of time and you want to take it slow and build up that grand slam, Jeff's going to put you on the birds. So get out there and contact him and let it rip and have a good one.
There it is. Awesome. And all right, bud. Thanks
for your
time.
Just enjoy it. Oh, no, thank you for your time.
Exactly right.
I appreciate it. Good luck on that kid coming.
All right, thanks. God bless.
God bless you. Bye.
Okay, thanks. Bye.
Come early spring, it's getting green. Fish are on the bed. Hear those turkeys gobble. Ringing in my head. The winter rise bass boat, here comes another year. Yeah, we command the outdoors round here. Oh, we command the outdoors. Yeah, we command the outdoors. Come summertime, we're feeling fine, fishing on the lake, flipping jigs and Carolina rigs, from early morning till real late. Bonfires on creek bank, kick back a couple beers, yeah, we command the outdoors around here. Yeah, we command the outdoors. Yeah, we command the outdoors. Next year's doves until you know winter's on the way. Brushing blinds and deer stands. The fever starts to creep. Fill our freezers full of ducks, lots of tender deer. Yeah, we command the outdoors around here. Yeah, we command the outdoors. Yeah, we command the outdoors. So grab your guns and shells, boys. Put on your camouflage. 'Cause we command the outdoors around here.